and welcome to the ORF's Ideas Factory. I'm Nagma. Joining me is Professor Harsh Pant. Let's look at the highlights this week. The U.S. Deputy Secretary of State, Wendy Sherman, visits India and Pakistan with different agendas. What does her visit signify? What does it mean for India, Pakistan, and the region? And of course, the question of Afghanistan. We'll look at that. The second point that we shall be looking at, another highlight, is the U.S.-China talks regarding Taiwan. The U.S.-China agree on following the Taiwan agreement, but at the same time, the tension between Taiwan and China is the worst in 40 years. And we will also look at EU and Poland. Is Polexit a possibility now? How will it impact the EU? How will it affect Poland and its economy? So all that, some of the, and of course, we will be taking some of your questions that you've been sending us. So we'll first start with Wendy Sherman's visit. Harsh, a very warm welcome to you. And let's look at the U.S. Deputy Secretary of State, Wendy Sherman's visit to Pakistan and India. And though she has also visited Pakistan, she has made a very interesting comment and said that there is no interest in returning to days of hyphenated India and Pakistan. A very interesting comment there, saying that she visited Pakistan with a specific purpose and the agenda was different. What does her visit signify, the visit to this area, and also the comments on Afghanistan, the talks about China? What does it mean for the India-US strategic partnership?
Thanks, Nagma. I think, you know what, when we look at the trajectory of Indo-US relations today, they tell you a story of two very close partners trying to come to terms with a world that is changing rapidly around them. And I think every question, therefore, every issue attains a new salience in the light of these developments. And increasingly, if you look at the Biden administration, the level of engagements that we have had with Biden administration is quite significant and speaks, I think, the optics speak for themselves. Not only has the Prime Minister visited, not only has he engaged with the U.S. President a number of times, both virtually and in person, which happened last month during the Quad Summit, but also the fact that we have had a succession of high-level visits to India, Secretary of State, Secretary of Defense, and now, of course, the Deputy Secretary of State coming to India, Wendy Sherman's visit, an important element in that continuous high-level engagement between two countries that see themselves as natural partners. And I think what happens is that every time there is Pakistan, when a U.S. official visits Pakistan, there are questions in India about what is happening? Are we again being hyphenated? Is this something that is going to cause damage to our long-term engagement? And I think Sherman was talking to that constituency in India, where she, in a very forthright sense, alluded to the fact that U.S.-Pakistan relationship is not going to go back to that period where they were close allies. I think what she's telling the world and to Indians, and that, look, this is a new era, new partnerships. U.S.-India engagement stands on its own merit. It stands, it is about much bigger things, much broader things, much more strategic things than, say, a limited set of agenda, as she said, vis-a-vis Pakistan. Mm-hmm. So I think largely we are looking at America or Washington trying to find a new modus vivendi with Islamabad and Rawalpindi, especially in the context of post-Afghanistan scenario. And therein, I think, lies both a challenge for India and an opportunity. Because the challenge is that there is an entire campaign going on now from the top levels of Pakistani establishment of pushing American strategic community into believing that incentivizing Taliban is going to be the norm, should be the norm, that you should engage with America, should engage with them and legitimize them and recognize them and move forward. That's the only way to solve Afghanistan conundrum. And I think the challenge for India is, how does India counter that narrative, and how do other like-minded countries, like-minded partners of India counter that narrative? And I think closer engagement on Afghanistan that we are witnessing between India and the US is one way of dealing with it. But I think there is also that opportunity that after a long time, US's reliance on Pakistan perhaps is at its lowest ebb. They are out of Afghanistan. They don't really need Pakistan. Pakistan will make a case time and time again that they, you know, that they rely, that they need, they are needed. But I think the message that we are getting now from Sherman and others is that a new that Washington is looking for new terms of engagement with Pakistan. So I think that is what India will have to carefully watch. But I think Sherman categorically stated that in India, that she's looking at Pakistan, or the Biden administration is looking at Pakistan through a limited set of agenda, and that agenda is being pursued in consultation with India. And I think that's a very important aspect of this engagement going forward.
Of course, it's really significant. She's saying that we are engaging with Pakistan on a limited agenda and not interested in going back to our relationship the way it was with Pakistan. She's also spoken, Harsh, about AUKUS and its significance. Would you like to elaborate upon that? Well, clearly, it shows Biden administration's focus on the Indo-Pacific, and she said that AUKUS can be a game changer. So, you know, looking at China, China's presence, the threat and the tension between China and US vis-a-vis Taiwan, all that being there, the significance of AUKUS that she has pointed towards.
Yes, because I think, for the US, Indo-Pacific is the real theater of activity. They are focused on it. They are committed to it. And of course, what is happening with Taiwan, what is happening with some of America's closest allies in the Indo-Pacific is an indication that that's a theater that is going to be the fulcrum of their engagement in the region, notwithstanding whatever is happening on India's western frontier. I think that will remain an important aspect of America's engagement, but increasingly, Indo-Pacific and India's eastern frontier, the Pacific, is where America is really investing its diplomatic energies on. And there have been concerns expressed in India about AUKUS. And I think Sherman looked and engaged with that subject by arguing, and in my opinion, rightly so, that you have a plethora of engagements, arrangements in the region. Most of them are actually complementary to each other. Whether it's AUKUS, whether it's Quad, whether you're looking at America's bilateral engagements with a number of partners, or even sitting here in New Delhi, if you look at India's own engagements with a number of India's partners. I think the agenda of AUKUS is very clear. It's a tripartite security arrangement. It's an almost an alliance relationship between three countries that have been longstanding alliance partners. With Quad, the agenda is wide-ranging. And that's something that India, as a non-alliance partner of the US, is beginning to engage with a set of countries in the Indo-Pacific that have similar worldview as far as the Indo-Pacific stability is concerned. So whether it is vaccine diplomacy, whether it is engagement on supply chains initiative, whether it is the issue of climate change, on all of these issues, India is willing to engage, as India has repeatedly said, with like-minded partners on an issue-based agenda. So I think for Sherman, it was important to clarify that in India, because there has been a lot of debate around that as to whether US is trying to divide the region, whether US is looking at it through a strategic and non-strategic prism. I think Sherman, in her own way, has tried to put an end to that debate. But I'm sure that it will continue for some more time till we have greater operational understanding of how these various structures are going to work.
Absolutely. And, we spoke about the Indo-Pacific region and the threat to stability in this region, of course, is China's increasing aggression. And China is seeing all kinds of groupings as a direct challenge to China's rise. But well, let's look at what's happening in Taiwan. The tension between China and Taiwan is at an all-time high. If you look at the last 40 years, a record number of Chinese sorties have been flying over the Taiwan defense airspace. And today, Xi Jinping has vowed a peaceful reunification of China with Taiwan. At the same time, on Twitter, if you see the trends, it's also the trend of Taiwan is not China is also trending. Now, all that is going on. And at the same time, the Biden administration, or the talk between Xi Jinping and Biden that took place, very clearly Biden said that we will abide by the Taiwan agreement. So US and Chinese diplomats have also met. The Taiwan agreement has also been talked about. At the same time, the US soldiers are apparently also training in Taiwan. US has been helping Taiwan with its defense. So Biden has to tread a very fine line, probably finer than ever, balancing between China and Taiwan.
Yes, I think this is a very delicate moment in the strategic evolution of the region and of, I think, China-Taiwan ties, because China is clearly under pressure. from multiple points. You know, we know the stories that are coming out from within China about economic pressures on China, energy pressures and energy challenges that China is facing. And of course, the pressure that China is now confronted with is that increasingly the like-minded countries in the region are willing to stand up to China on issue after issue. And they are willing to respond to that. They are willing to almost make their presence felt. They're making it very clear that from infrastructure, from trade and technology, from supply chain resilience, almost all of these issues are now being looked at very carefully, and like-minded countries are willing to work in coalitions to stand up to what many of them feel is Chinese aggression. And I think that puts China under pressure, especially Xi Jinping under pressure, because his entire presidency is premised on this belief of Chinese national rejuvenation. And so any sign that shows him in a weaker spot can be extremely damaging for him politically. And Taiwan presents a unique case, because increasingly, if you think about the move away from all the wars that America has been fighting, now as America's footprint grows in the Indo-Pacific, Taiwan is one area, Taiwan is one issue, which in a way has mobilized not only American body politic, but also global public opinion. The kind of focus on Taiwan today is at its high, we have not seen in a very, very long time. Of course, as the Taiwanese minister himself has said, that the tensions are very high, but it must also be recognized that the world is looking at Taiwan through a very different lens post-COVID. And as China becomes more aggressive, there is great sympathy for Taiwan in large parts of the world. And the world community is sort of coming together and saying that, look, something needs to be done about Taiwan. So I think that also puts pressure on China. So the whole debate on reunification, on how that unification will happen, that there is a new spotlight. Now, of course, this is the week when Taiwan celebrates its national day, and Xi Jinping had to respond to that. So he's in some ways again promising that unification will happen, that we will become one China and two systems policy. But no one really buys that argument after Hong Kong in Taiwan. We have seen how the public sentiment has been eroding, and it's going away from China. So clearly, I think on multiple fronts, China is under pressure, and that makes for a very dangerous situation. Because that can easily lead to miscalculations and misunderstandings. And so for Mr. Biden, and I think for the US, it also creates a dilemma. Washington has to ensure that certain red lines are not crossed, but they also have to ensure that China does not become so anxious that it reaches out for guns. So in that context, I think the engagement between Biden and Xi this week was interesting and important, because it's, in a way, Washington was reiterating one China policy, but Washington is also committed to help Taiwan defend itself. So therefore, everything that America has done in the past few years, and there is a greater urgency to it in terms of defense spending, in terms of defense help that America can provide. And as you were mentioning, in terms of operational and tactical training that American forces can provide to the Taiwanese forces. And as I think the situation evolves, there's going to be pressure not only on Washington, but increasingly on the entire region, because Taiwan Straits sit at the heart of the Indo-Pacific. And of course, all countries in the region will be at some point will come under pressure to enunciate their policies much more categorically. So I think it is in no one's interest that it boils beyond a point. But China is increasingly making it very, very difficult for other countries not to take a position, given the bellicosity that it is showing and the pressures that I think Xi Jinping is facing both at home and internationally.
So, of course, Xi Jinping is clearly facing a lot of pressure internally, which is why he has reiterated that this will be sorted out without any interference from any other country. Today, he's again said that very categorically, that peaceful reunification with Taiwan will happen and it does not need any interference from any other country. But like you pointed out, Biden has to maintain a very fine balance, balancing between recognizing the one China policy and popping up Taiwan's ability to defend itself. Another issue that I would like you to comment upon is the is Poland actually moving away from EU? Is that a possibility? This already on the lines of Brexit, a term that is now being used as Polexit, that Poland will exit EU. EU membership relies upon a complete and unconditional adherence to a common value and rule. And EU has warned that it will use all its powers against Poland. Poland's High Court has challenged the supremacy of EU law. Looking at all this, and if this happens, if Poland actually exits EU, how will it affect Poland economically? Especially this is a time after the pandemic when it could have received a lot of grants being a member of the EU. But now if it moves out of EU, how will that affect its economy and what does it really mean for the European Union?
I think this episode with Poland once again points to the fundamental problem that European Union is facing. It tries to make a case for this sort of uniformity across various countries and in a uniform approach, not only domestically in domestic laws, but also in international politics. And I think that is, Brexit was a manifestation of the dissatisfaction that many in Britain felt about the control from Brussels. And I think what Poland is demonstrating, this case is demonstrating, that there is, that it, you know, it, that this, that that dissatisfaction is also something that other nations are feeling. And we have talked in the past, about how during the high tide of COVID, there were countries like Italy also expressing, and Spain also expressing their dissatisfaction with the way Brussels was treating them. So I think, there is a trend here in terms of the democratic deficit that many countries feel, that you have a technocracy, a technocratic elite in Brussels that are devoid of a ground level engagement with the countries in question. And therefore, a dissatisfaction emerges that, look, our views are not being represented. Now, the national governments represent that democratic element. They are the ones that represent the sentiments in some ways of the ordinary population of Poland in this case. Now, if they are saying that they are dissatisfied with the way European law takes supremacy over the domestic laws, then I think this is something that a sovereign state anywhere in the world would articulate. And this is to brush it aside, would continue to cause this problem and this hemorrhaging of support for European Union that some have witnessed in some countries that has been witnessed, is I think that manifestation of this desire to break the shackles from this dependence on Brussels and this control that Brussels exerts. Now, it is going to be, I don't think this is going to resolve one way or another very soon. I don't think it's in the interest of the Polish elite to say that, well, enough is enough and we are moving out. And I think there is also some evidence that, Polish nationals themselves are divided on this question. We don't have, the surveys are not one way or the other. But I think that the question that this episode is raising is once again, how can European Union make itself relevant to contemporary realities? That the older institutional structure is no longer serving the interests, and what can the European Union do to manage some of these contradictions? It is a conglomeration of some of the most diverse democratic countries in the world, and yet you have this feeling of democratic deficit that brews up again and again and again. So something needs to go, but what? It's not entirely clear, and I think given that the challenges, that stakes are very high again. If this debate starts gathering momentum, mm-hmm. either in Poland or in other countries, which some of these other countries also have similar views on these questions, then I think it would be very damaging for the European Union.
So the dissatisfaction that many nations are facing is actually now being voiced. And you're saying that it's time that European Union looks within and looks at actually reorienting itself and changing itself. The Polish PM has also commented that EU should not be only a grouping of those who are equal or more equal. So that's an important comment. We have time, only for this much on this episode of the Ideas Factory. But before we close, Harsh, I would like you to answer at least one question that our viewers have sent. Jaydeep Gadavi is asking, though it's not really related to what we've been discussing today, but he's asking, as far as international discussion about Prevention of Terrorism Act of Sri Lanka is concerned, do you think India is better off leaving it as an internal matter of Sri Lanka, or raise it along with the 13th Amendment. Would you like to comment upon that?
Well, I think at this point, it seems to me that that India will have to engage with it bilaterally with Sri Lanka rather than making it a multilateral issue. And I think India and Sri Lanka have enough channels available bilaterally to take this matter forward. For India, it's always a delicate matter when it wants to engage with its neighbors. Most of its neighbors feel that India already is this big brother and that tries to intervene in their domestic matters. So I think India has to be very sensitive to some of these issues, especially when it concerns its neighbors. And we have to be sensitive to the fact that this is also a reflection of their own politics responding to the challenge that they perceive that they are facing. We may have a different point of view, but I don't think multilateral, raising it up multilaterally when we have options available bilaterally is the way to go.
All right. Thank you so much, Harsh, for that answer. And thank you for joining us on this episode of the Ideas Factory. Do send in your questions. We shall see you next week.